there.
Stop that, nip that in the bud. I can't say that because when I start to listen, I would like to be on track. I can't say that. There's always a reason.
All right. Y'all ready?
Amen.
Let's stand and sing this together, all right? Oh, we're in G.
Yep.
I'm blessed. How about you?
Amen.
Amen.
She is. How about the rest of you?
Amen.
I'm blessed. I'm blessed. It's not by anything we've done. I think sometimes we think, well, I earned this. I haven't earned a thing. The only thing I can say is that I believe that Jesus Christ has saved me, washed me, and made me white as snow. How he does it, I don't know. I'm just grateful. And if I believe it, it's done in my life. Amen.
Amen. Yes.
It's a grand and glorious feeling to walk and talk with our Savior. Amen. I'm so glad I heard my Savior gently pleading. Now I'm an errant child of God, I truly know. All the way home is precious and is daily meeting.
It's a grand and glorious feeling as I go.
Well, it's a grand and glorious feeling
just to be a child of God. How a grand and glorious feeling as I go.
It's a grand,
well, it's a grand and glorious feeling just to be a child of God. How His love comes over me stealing.
Things start going in the other direction.
That's right.
We must trust Him in all that we face and all that we do. He set me free.
Yes, He did.
You've got to sing a little bit. I'm losing my voice. Oh. Praise the Lord. Amen. No, not amen that I'm losing my voice. Pray that I don't lose it. All right. Well, once like a bird in prison, I dwelt. No freedom from my sorrow I felt. But Jesus came and He listened to me, and glory to God, He set me free. Well, He set me free,
yes,
He set me free, and
He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus. Glory to God, He set me free. Now I am climbing higher each day. Darkness of night has drifted away. My feet are planted on higher ground, and glory to God. Broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm not of this world shall turn me around. Daily I'm working and I'm praying to, and glory to God.
Song is a lot older than me. Been around for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. And yet it never loses its meaning, never loses the message that's in it. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Mm-hmm. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but thank God now I can see.
Hallelujah.
And if you know him in a personal way, you know exactly what that song is talking about. Mm-hmm. How that God took you out of the darkness of your sin and brought you into the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we see that light in the face of Jesus Christ. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Years.
Praise the Lord. I feel His presence this morning, don't you? I do. Give me a minute here. Words over here. But I think, you know why we feel His presence? Because the Bible says, if you seek me, you shall find me. So, you know, we're seeking after Him.
Yes.
He's not going to hide. He's going to show up. He wants to be with us. He wants to bless us. He wants us to feel His presence and enjoy our company. You know, I just feel the feeling like the Lord just been not so much telling me, but I just been feeling like I just want to have company with you, Chris. I just want to hang out with you. You know, do you ever just want to hang out with somebody? You know, like you miss them. And I just want to hang out. I don't want to bother you. But I think that's how God is with us a lot of most of the time. And I've been feeling that lately. Just Like, and when I find myself just like hanging out with him, what do you mean by hanging out? I just, like, he's always hanging out with me. I'm not trying to preach it, just something that just came in my heart. But he's always there. But like, he knows when we go the extra step. You know what I'm saying? When we get up and just spend some time with him and pray and just, you know, just spend that time. I woke up yesterday morning and just, I had this, this songwriter, he was a well-known minister, and he kind of a, I don't know, folk rock Christian early in the late 70s. His name was Keith Green, and Pastor Ron might have mentioned him here a few weeks ago, and I don't know what it was, I just got up thinking about his life, and you know, that's the amazing thing about YouTube, is that you can go on YouTube and pretty much watch a lot of great stuff, you know, and I found our story there. It was a documentary on him and his life, kind of how he got started. And my wife got up, we ended up just watching the whole thing about an hour and a half. And it was just, she never really, she heard about it, but never heard a lot about him. And it was just really inspiring and it was moving. And I came down to the church. I was here for a little while yesterday afternoon. And I actually was in my office and I found a one of his, he doesn't have a lot of CDs or a company CD that you can sing to, but this song I had come across, and I just had been on my heart, and I wanted to sing it this morning and pray that and minister to you as well. Amen. He had a real passion for the Lord. He had a real desire for Jesus.
Burn. your grace abound.
Love the Lord this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Bless you.
Jesus, precious Jesus, hope for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, hope for grace to trust Him more.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lisa.
Hallelujah.
Pastor Chris. I remember being on a mission trip when I first heard a song Pastor Chris sang. It was with Tommy Funks, and he was a real Keith Green fan. Have people that you like to listen to, people that you were fans of. Keith Green didn't fit the mold. Wasn't accepted in a lot of circles. He was part of the Jesus movement back in the 70s, and so many times, because we were raised, I hate to say this, but because we were raised to be judgmental, we judged everybody. Either your hair wasn't right, or your clothes weren't right, or you didn't speak with the right terminology. You were a little bit maybe more crass than maybe a lot of folks would accept. And yet there were some men back in those days that went past all of the religious protocol and just reached out to touch Jesus. That's all they wanted. They were looking for fame. They wrote from their heart songs. And I can just imagine when he wrote that song, he was probably in prayer somewhere, and he got a glimpse of how wonderful Jesus is. And then he just started to sing, Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. And then you think of a woman that she didn't fit the mold either. At least it just sang about. She was considered an outcast. She was considered unimportant as far as the religious circles of Jesus' day was concerned. But she loved him. I mean, she loved him. She had a precious box of oil. Very expensive. Even the disciples had said, well, couldn't this have been sold and the money given to the poor? And Jesus said, the poor you have always with you, but me you do not have always. He says, she is anointing my body to the burial. And that's amazing to me how religious folks will look at people that really, really love Jesus and they can make fun of them. I'm going to talk about the world. The world already thinks we're crazy, so. But when people that are supposed to love Jesus make fun of those that really do, I'm bothered. I pray that in our hearts, we love him. And it's not just something we do outwardly, you know, in front of people, but deep down in our heart, we're just so in love with Him, that when you talk to us, He's who we want to talk about.
Yeah.
Not looking to try to impress you with words or anything like that. We just want people to see Christ. And I think He's gotten lost in the religious form and fashion of the day. He has seemingly gotten lost in our production-based Christianity, where that everything has to be perfect. And I've found in my life that when His presence comes, everything is perfect. It just flows. It's like water going down a river. You can't stop it. And I'm grateful that I know some folks that love Him. I like to think I do. My heart, I like to think that I'm trying my best to be as real as I can. Because I don't know how many days I have left on this earth, but it's like I tell Pastor Chris this morning, I know I'm closer to the end than I am to the beginning. Which is the case with a lot of us. Realize that time has passed and the years have added up in our lives, and the hair has changed color, step has gotten slower, but the love for Christ seems to be more intense. As we get closer to the other side, we lose our affections and our desires for what's on this side, and we're starting to look on the other side. And I guess the greatest struggle for me is that I fall in love with people that love Jesus and then they leave. And so the only thing I have to look forward to is that one day I'll see them again over on the other side. And I look forward to those days. And you never know how far they're off. It could be right around the corner. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Turn with me this morning. I want to get all caught up and going off chasing a rabbit somewhere, although I like looking at rabbits. I don't know if I want to eat one. A lot of folks like them. I always read the scriptures in the law, you're not supposed to eat those things, but people still eat them. But, you know, I eat stuff that the law said I wasn't supposed to also, so I'm glad I'm under grace. So I can have a lobster or a crab leg every now and then. Amen. Praise the Lord. I don't like to go back so many times under the law, and things that are under the law I understand are things that God has brought us past to a certain extent. And yet I feel in my heart that sometimes we need to go back and just remind ourselves that there are some things that God has put in His holy word to help us. Things that need to be part of who we are. Thank God for His grace. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm grateful for the grace of God. But if I have a title or a thought for this message this morning, it would be Wisdom from the Old Testament. Wisdom from the Old Testament. And there are some things here that if we will adhere to them and listen to them, they can actually be a blessing in your life. They can guard you and guide you. And I don't know of anybody in this world that doesn't need guidance in some areas in their life. We all need God's direction so that we know which way to go. And I don't know exactly how all this will go, because you know, it's just in my reading this week, I came across this, and I just felt like I wanted to try and share some of it from Deuteronomy chapter 4. Moses is rehearsing or rehashing things that God had told him. He's telling them again in the book of Deuteronomy to the children of Israel. Now, you have to understand something about Moses. He's doing this knowingly that he's not going to be able to enter into the promised land. God has already told him, you don't get to go. And the reason he doesn't get to go is because he broke away from the type and the shadow that God had designed. When he spoke, God spoke to him and told him to speak to the rock. Moses, like most pastors that get frustrated, got angry. And so instead of speaking to the rock, He smote it, not once, but twice. And the New Testament says Christ was smitten once. And so he was a picture, this was a picture of Christ being smitten again. And so because he didn't keep the type that God had laid out, God said, you can't go in. But he did let him look at it. And I don't know about you, but I think it's pretty good when God lets you look into the place where all the people that you've been leading all these years are getting to go, and then he buries you. You know, it's one thing to go down to Michigan Memorial or one of these other places and get buried, but nobody knows where Moses is buried because they knew they would probably make an idol out of him. Because the children of Israel, whether we want to believe it or not, became idol worshipers. They were people that just didn't get it for some reason. Can't fault them. I can't say bad things about them because we're just like them. We got the same issues, the same struggles, the same battles. Oh, they may be in a different venue, where you're living in a different time, but still our battles are the same. We think we know what we're supposed to do, and so we're going to do our dead level best to do it. Doesn't make it right. Doesn't mean that we're going in the right way, but we are our own person, so we're going to do our thing until somebody gives us some instruction and tells us how to live. And so Moses is setting these things down in chapter 4 for the children of Israel because he knows he's not going to be around very much longer, and he's going to have to give them some instruction because he realizes how forgetful they are. Hello? Are we forgetful? Man, are we ever. We don't remember last 2 weeks ago's blessing, much less the one that we're having this morning. Right? We're like people that are drug addicts. We got to get another fix every time we come, because if God didn't give us our fix of his touch on our lives, we probably couldn't make it. Thank God that he touches us. Thank God that he motions things in our lives, does things in our lives, sends Lisa to sing us a song, sends, you know, somebody to give a shout, somebody to give a prayer, somebody to give a message. Thank God he sends somebody along to encourage us, because there's not a person in this room that doesn't need encouraging. I do. I need encouragement. I'm sorry. You think I'm the pastor and I don't need it, but I do. I need to hear that I'm loved. I need to hear that the message was good. I need to hear that the song was okay. I mean, I'm as human as the next person. We all need each other. We all need encouragement. Moses begins, well, he began over in chapter 1, but I'm going over into chapter 4. And if you follow with me just for a couple of minutes, I want to share a couple of things with you. He's speaking to the children of Israel, and he says these words, "Now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and the judgments which I teach you, for to do them, that ye may live and go into the possess the land which the Lord God your fathers giveth you." I wrote down a little thing here, but we need to learn how to listen. You know, we need to learn how to listen. You know, you can't hear God if you're not listening. If you're always barking, if you're always telling God what you want, what you need, what your issues are, you need to listen sometimes, because sometimes he's telling you how to get past whatever you're going through, and yet you're not listening enough because you're too busy complaining or grumbling about, you know, whatever you're going through, and we all go through stuff. The word to listen here means to hear intelligently, often with implications of attention or obedience. In other words, I listen so that I can obey. It's like sometimes when you're trying to instruct your children, you tell them something, and it's like it just goes in this ear, right out that one. And so sometimes when you want to get your point across, you raise your voice. And then you grab them by the cheeks, and you pull them up close and say, "Listen, I'm trying to tell you something. I'm trying to instruct you. I'm trying to show you how to learn how to be obedient." God sometimes seems to need to grab us by the cheeks and say, "How come you're not listening? You ask me to help you, and then I'm trying to help you, but then when I try to help you, you don't listen to what I'm telling you to do, and so you don't do it, and because you don't do it, you don't get the instruction that you need, and so you don't get the guidance that you asked for, even though you asked for it. Make sense? Help me, God, to listen to you. Listen, his statutes. He said, keep the statutes and commandments. His statutes tell us what to do. That's what they're about. They tell you what to do. And then his judgments tell us how to do it. So if I listen to the statutes and the judgments, I don't only get told what to do, I get told how to do it. Wouldn't that be nice? If God told you something and then he told you how to do it. Just like when he took Moses up into the mountain and he gave him the instructions for the tabernacle. And he said, now see, when you get back down there, I've given you the statutes and the judgments. I've showed you exactly how it's supposed to be. Don't deviate from the plan. Don't make up your own idea. Don't do it your way. Do it my way. And, you know, we're not Frank Sinatra, so we don't do it our way. And it went over some of your head. You know, he sang that song, I did it my way. Well, I've discovered my way is not the best way. But his way is always the best way. When I listen to him, I'm okay. I really am okay when I listen to him. My problem is when I'm listening to me, and I do what Ron wants to do, rather than what God's telling me to do. Now, I know none of you do that. But I have this problem. That Ron, a lot of times, gets in the way. Does Chris ever get in the way? Does Sandy ever get in the way? Does Lois ever get in the way? Does Barb ever get in the way? Yeah, we all get in our own way sometimes. We do our own thing. And we think it's okay until all of a sudden we're walking along and things aren't going as well as we'd like for them to. And so we run back to the altar and we say, God, I'm sorry. Please help me. Because he gives us instruction. He tells us what to do. So we get out there and we start doing it. But God's word is a proceeding word. You understand that, I hope. We live by every, not by every word of God, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. In other words, his word is a proceeding word. It's continually evolving. He's taking us into new levels, into places that maybe we would not have gone had we not been willing to listen. God wants to take us places in him that maybe we've not been to yet. I know I've come to places in God over the past few years that I never thought I would come to. There's places in God that, you know, I was stuck at for a long time. I used to hang people over hell by a thread and scream and yell and holler and say, now, if you don't give your heart and life to Jesus, you're going to die and split hell wide open. And it's like, God, that's not encouraging. I want to hear him tell me he loves me. I don't want to hear somebody tell me he's trying to kill me. Verse 2. You shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandment of the Lord your God which I command you. Listen. We must learn how to be obedient. Don't, you know, just because you change the definition of something doesn't mean that it's true. They've changed the definition of words over time in our society. And so rather than, I mean, it sounds better, I guess, to a lot of folks, rather than to say they murdered the baby, that they aborted the baby. Because, you know, it really wasn't a baby. But I mean, I think of what God told Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. But you think that was just for him? Does anybody have that misconception that he just knew Jeremiah before he formed him in the womb? Or did he know all of us? He knew every one of us. Before we were ever formed in the womb, before we became a twinkle in our daddy's eye,